service, we normally take an offering, and we didn't do that during this COVID era. We do take an offering, but we do it a little different fashion. We have a red box in the back if you're in the sanctuary. And if you're online, giving online is a big, big help for both of our churches. You'll see there on the screen, Mountain View, you can give online. So again, it's Scottsdale Presbyterian Church as well. Well, it has been quite a week, has it not? Quite a week. There was a long build-up. There was an expectation. Finally, yesterday, we saw a result, and many are ecstatic, and many are disappointed. It was back and forth. Of course, I speak of the terrible ASU loss yesterday. Oh, you thought I was talking about the election. There was that too, which I do want to talk about this morning. In fact, I'm going to depart from that we've been doing a study through a Tim Keller book. I'm going to depart from this chapter this week, and then I'll regain it next week. But I want to kind of pause the next 3 weeks to do a little bit of a mini sermon series, basically asking how do we live in light of the election and live into this world that is very polarized. How do we as a church respond? And this morning, I want to talk about our tribe. Next week, I'm going to talk about our leader. And then the following week, we'll round out this series talking about our calling. So this morning, we're going to talk about our tribe. Where do we, as Jesus followers, belong? Who are our people? What is our affiliation and association? This morning, I'm going to look at a text from Mark's Gospel, the third chapter, verses 31 through 35. Let's stand and honor God's Word. Then his mother and brothers came, and standing outside, they said to him and called him. A crowd was sitting around him, and they said to him, "Your mother and your brothers and sisters are outside asking for you." And he replied, "Who are my mother and my brothers?" And looking at those who sat around him, he said, Here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does the will of God is my brother and sister and mother." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. T.S. Eliot, the poet, said these words, "Do not let me hear of the wisdom of old men, but rather of their folly. Their fear of fear and frenzy, their fear of possession, of belonging to another, or to others, or to God. The only wisdom," he said, "the only wisdom we can hope to acquire is the wisdom of humility. Humility is endless." Let us pray. Lord, these words are yours, and thus it is right for you to speak them. And we pray you do just that through the power of your Holy Spirit. So help us in our listening and clear our minds of fear and worry, that we might hear your word, your eternal word, that does not today is vastly different, radically different from the typical family of even the first half of the last century. For most of human history, almost all of human history, family was defined much bigger than it is today. Family was a tribe. It included a lot of people. Your family was aunts, uncles, cousins. They lived in the same maybe street block. They were all together. You would always think of family as a tribe. But then in the 1950s, we moved away from that. We moved to the suburbs. And suddenly, family was now defined as simply two parents and the children. It shrank. It got really small. Now it's changing even more. So many one-parent homes. So many foster children. It's a huge epidemic in the city of Phoenix. How many kids do not have parents? This is a radical departure from the way family has always been. But what hasn't changed is our deep need for a tribe. We all have a deep need for a tribe, a group of people where they know us, where a group accepts us, where they live near us, where generally they believe like we do. They insulate us. They correct us when needed. They affirm us when that's appropriate. We all have that need for a tribe, and the family has gotten so small or non-existent, but the need hasn't gone away. When your family is a tribe, you, back in the olden days, previous generations, one of the things about it is it was so big that you were forced to learn how to live with others. Always in a tribe, there were going to be people who thought differently than you. Oh, that's a crazy uncle, you know. But he's my tribe, and I love him. He thinks completely different than me, but I absolutely love him. He's a part of who I am. But even though we see things very, very differently, you were stuck with these people. They were a part of you. But in today's world, we tend to choose our tribe. And who do we choose? We choose people that think exactly the way we do. We choose people that look the way we do. And act the way we do, share our same worldview. It's a tribe because we have to have one that we choose, not one that's given to us. In our lesson this morning, in the gospel lesson, we learned that people came to Jesus and they said, "Your mother and your brothers are outside looking for you. Your family's here." Why is Jesus' family coming to look for him? Well, in chapter 3 of Mark, we learn that things aren't going all that well for Jesus. He's incredibly busy. He didn't even have time to stop and eat it is to still become. The first thing we learn about Jesus' tribe is that it is diverse. Jesus' new family is a very diverse one. He chose followers from all parts, from different ethnic backgrounds, in his just little circle of 12. From polar opposites of the political spectrum, he chose to be in his family. People with all kinds of different beliefs about how the world ought to run, how the Romans were running things, how they were running things. He brought people together from a vastly diverse perspective. And we live in a very hyper-partisan world right now, do we not? It's very hyper. We've just lived through this past season. Partisanship is very difficult for Jesus' followers. Because partisanship is fueled by winning and by acquiring power. It needs to build up one's own tribe at the expense of the other. We have been living through this season and it's taxing. I don't know about you, but it's draining. Partisanship that is hyper like only been through demands that you demean the others. In order to build yourself up, you have to have people that you are radically against. We have heard this, whatever side you're on, we have heard so much about how those people are. How dreadful those people are. Can you believe what they believe? Do you not know what they will do when they acquire power? Or if they keep power? That's been the narrative that we hear over and over again. And it's all talked about in some very, very unpleasant terms. But Jesus' tribe is very different from that. It is not fueled by power, but it is fueled by sacrifice. The heart of his tribe is this thing, let's give ourselves away. Let's give up power. Not by boasting about how great we are and how we are, but let's be fueled by humility. Let's not be led by harsh rhetoric against the other, but let's be led by kindness and welcoming. You know, Jesus was a scandal. To religious folk. Very interesting. Religious people of Jesus' day thought he was an absolute scandal. He was continually labeled guilty by association. That was one of the big charges about him, charges against him. When sinners invited him to their parties, he went. When crooks, prostitutes, gluttons, and drunks came near, he welcomed them. He had dinner with these people. That was in that day, to have dinner with someone was to signify and say, I welcome you, I support you, I'm a part of you, I want to be with you. And he did this all before they repented. And the religious people said, how in the world could he love people who think differently than him, who act differently like this? But he did. So he had to look at the other tribes and say, oh my gosh, we're so much better, I can't be with them. He looked at other tribes as people who needed love, who needed to be listened to and cared for. The second thing we learn about his tribe is that it is gentle. You know, one of the interesting things about Jesus and his followers, one of the big frustrations they had was that he wasn't political enough. Isn't that interesting? He didn't get involved in politics enough. Today we're living through a season where people will say, if you're not with us, you're against us. If you didn't vote for us, you're definitely against us. We're living in a season right now where people are saying, I can't work with people who voted in a different way than I did. Where people are leaving social media because of this. You know, they're doing studies now. Not many people get married later in life now. They're not getting married as often, younger people. But now they're discovering raise a kid to the judge's vote. And now we don't do that anymore. You see, now we have this tribalism that says, if you are not in my tribe, then you are out. You are canceled. I cannot associate. And Jesus did the opposite. He freely associated with, celebrated with, partied with, sat with, ate meals with people who were completely outside of his tribe. And everyone said, you are guilty, Jesus, by association. If you had dinner with them, well, then you must be one of them. Jesus did not operate the way the world does. Amen. They said about Jesus, you're not political enough. We have a bad leader, Jesus. We have a really bad leader. He's awful, and we've got to get him out. The disciples got frustrated because they kept saying to Jesus, isn't it time that we got rid of the leader? We got a bad one, we got to get rid of him. And Jesus kept saying this, my kingdom's different. I'm bringing in a different kingdom. And the end, Judas couldn't stand it anymore. If you're not going to overthrow the leader, be about that, then I can't be a part of you. Maybe the other apostles were in that same position as well. We don't know. Jesus was never in a hurry or anxious about any of that. He knew that there were going to be bad leaders. There would be seasons where there were bad leaders. He knew that. And through all of it, he was gentle and patient and kind. When the storm was raging around them, the leader of this Jesus tribe that you and I are in, when the storm was raging, our leader was asleep at the front of the boat. Calm, gentle, not anxious. He was not afraid. And he calls us followers to do like that. Friends, our world right now needs calm, non-anxious people. It really does need people that say, yeah, I understand that things are a mess, but God's in control. We need people who believe and say that God is in no hurry, so we can be people who relax and wait. God is in control, so we don't have to be. God is winning, so we don't have to. Jesus was so gentle with people and kind to people who did not believe the way he did, who had different worldviews. And he calls us to be similar. When there were bad leaders on the throne, he said, trust me, follow me. I'm building a new kingdom and a new tribe of people. And we're not going to be completely sold out just for our tribe. We're also going to love and care for other tribes as well. Which leads us to our final point. Jesus' family or tribe seeks the welfare of the city. When the Hebrews were picked up and carried away from Jerusalem, and they were carried to exile to live in Babylon, they had lives that they were beginning, and they had to work, and they had to do things and begin their lives. But think about that. They were in a foreign country with a foreign leader, and Jeremiah wrote to them and said, you're here now. I want you to build and plant. I also want you to seek the welfare of the city. God said, you have a really terrible leader in Babylon. You have a bad government. But here's what I want you to do in response. God didn't say, I want you to organize a political action committee, get out the vote, and vote them out of office. And if you get enough people, then you'll get power, then you can make things right. He didn't say that. He said, seek the welfare of the city. I want you to build and help build a prosperous city. Care for people who are hurting in the city. The early Christians did just that. The Romans were in power. They were terrible leaders, terrible government. But the early Christians amazed the Romans because they had two things that were so strange to the Romans. They couldn't understand this new group, this new tribe. One was their sexual purity. That was like so strange to them. But the other was their radical generosity with their wealth and this is impressive.